Bindis peria sopeli tanda tanu probindeba. Naris chveni sitotsole chiti vid gaguprindeba. Naris chveni sitotsole chiti vid gaguprindeba.
Once you have admitted that Basque language, in fact, is Kartvelian, belongs to the Kartvelian family, you have no other option but to admit it, you inevitably will come to a conclusion that the rest of Spain is as Kartvelian as well, or used to be as Kartvelian as well. The bottom line would be that Spain, or exactly the Pyrenaic Peninsula, that which, as it used to be before it started being Spain, used to be inhabited by tribes, Basque-like tribes, that spoke languages very, very close to the Basque language, and altogether they belong. We have a right to claim so now. They belong to the Kartvelian family. We have already seen that people in the south of Spain used to use Basque words in their speech and used to bear Basque surnames. Now we will see it in fuller details. As it had been said in the film Kartvelian Spain, the first thing to look at if you want to establish the true history, linguistic history of Spain, the first thing to do would be to have a thorough look at the maps of Ptolemy, who mentions a huge number of ancient tribes, so-called Iberian tribes, all over Spain. And most of those tribes, the names of most of those tribes look extremely similar. And for those who know, who have just at least surface knowledge of Georgian language, look very Kartvelian. So, Laetani, Caretani, Bastetani, Turdetani, Ceretani, Autetani, Hakitani, Editani, Lobetani, among others. They all, first of all, they all end with an or ani suffix, which is typical both for Indo-European family and for the Kartvelian family as well. So we can take this suffix off, and we will be left with the root, which also ends similarly throughout the whole list. That would be Laeti, Careti, Basteti, Turdeti, Cereti, Auteti, Haketi, Edeti, and Lobeti. Again, those who know Georgian language, or even those who have traveled to Georgia, they should know that such Eti ending is an extremely typical Georgian ending for the local provinces. Georgia today consists of such provinces as Kaheti, Imereti, Svaneti, Mtiuleti, Hevsureti, Javaheti, among others. Also, you will find the same toponymic, extremely toponymic suffix in the names of cities like Ozurgeti, for example, Kobuleti, in the names of different small villages, Odeti, Tianeti, Kianeti, etc. The meaning of the suffix is the land of the root the suffix is ended to. So, Laeti, from the point of Georgian language, would be land of La. Careti would be land of Kari, Basteti land of Basti, land of Turdi, land of Ceri, land of Auti, land of Haki, Edi, and Lobi. You can see that here. So now, in order to be able to decipher those ancient Iberian tribes in Spain, you need to find Georgian or Megrelian or any Kartvelian meanings for the roots, for the very roots of those tribe names. And the meanings should be such as the meanings should be justifying, the meanings should justify the presence of those Kartvelian words as roots of the names of those tribes. And we will try to do that now. Well, again, in the film Kartvelian-Spanish, it was done it was done in Spain, it was filmed in Spain, it looks more more detailed. Now we will just have a quick look at it. And we start with Cerdanya. Cerdanya, that's a modern region located in the mountains of Pyrenees. And it definitely comes from the name, ancient name of Ceretani, which was placed by Ptolemy at the same territory. We have already found out that the name has the word Ceri as its root, and it should mean something significant in a Georgian language, significant enough to understand why the whole region, the whole tribe was called with this name. In a Georgian language, tseri means a stack of rye, or actually stack of any hay. And from this word, we can make a toponym tsereti, that would be land of haystacks, rye stacks. By the way, the famous Georgian surname Tsereteli, that's an adjective made out of exactly this toponym tsereti. And finally, a representative of this of this land would be called Ceretani or Ceretian, if you want to pronounce it the English way. So that would be an adjective. This exact adjective we see on the map of Ptolemy. So what about stacks of rye? Why stacks of rye? The answer is the fact that Cerdanya and Cereti is a plain. It's located in mountains, but actually it's an inside plain, which should be, and in fact is, strongly associated with land tilling, because the local people who lived in mountains, they still needed to consume quite an amount of bread. And Cerdanya, Cereti, a plain, is a wonderful place to grow it. And when I went there for the first time, I was very eager I thought that I already deciphered the name, and I wanted confirmation. I was very eager to find stacks of rye in Cerdanya. And actually, while you drive through this land, you see things like that all over on both sides of the road. So yes, Cerdanya associates with stacks of hay. So there are lots of them there, and that's the reason why the land was called with this Georgian word. The overall construction is Georgian as well. In the province of Aragon, you will find on the map of Ptolemy, you will find a very, very interesting name of Edetani. Actually, that would be the country itself would be called Edeti, which in its turn should be interpreted as land of Edi. So what is Edi? The answer would be the Georgian Masdar Edeba, which consists of exactly the root in question, Ed, plus trademark ending for Georgian Masdar Eba. Among other things, the word edeba means get entangled round. So actually, it's any action that implies a round motion. Very unexpectedly, you find that one of the dictionaries on internet, which translates from Georgian to Polish, translates the word edi, which does not exist alone in the Georgian dictionary, only as a part of the Masdar Edeba, as I showed before. But this dictionary does translate the word edi from Georgian into Polish as vir. That would be a verb pool. And we, those who speak English language, we immediately associate it with the word edi, English word edi. That means the same thing. It means verb pool. And now we, the last thing that we need, I have no idea where this dictionary takes this word, edi, the Georgian word edi, but I do understand that it's the same as the root for this masdar, deba. And now the last thing to understand would be why exactly whirlpools. The answer is on the modern maps of Spain, where you will find, well, first of all, you will see that this is the region where the one of the main Spanish rivers, Ebro, actually flows. But also you will see that exactly where Ptolemy places the tribe of Edetani, which should be, as we understand now, connected to the concept of whirlpools, obviously on the Ebro River. Today you will find, very close to the city of Saragossa, you will find a small town called Remolinos, which from Spanish language translates exactly as whirlpools. Now we're going to Catalonia, where Ptolemy places a tribe of Laetani, which is that would be representative of a person living on in a country called Laeti, which in its turn is a country of La. The word La is present in the very old and very important dictionary of Georgian language compiled by Sulhan Saba Orbeliani in the 18th century, where, as we see, La means the same as Lia. In its turn, Lia is interpreted in this dictionary as Soflobita Lahi, which is actually a marsh, boggy land. So Laeti, from this point of view, immediately turns into marshland. The word Laeti is very important for the history of local land. For we find this name in the very center of Barcelona, where a street called Laetana runs more or less parallel to the Ramblas. It's one of the main streets in Barcelona. So that's land of marshes, marshland. Why is it marshland? Because actually that's still is and used to be much more in the ancient times, still is land of marshes. Around Barcelona you will see quite a number of various pools. Most of them are of technical nature now. They serve Barcelona's water needs, but in ancient times there used to be natural reservoirs, and now we see why this land used to be called like that. Interestingly, we will later find the same, absolutely the same name, Laeti, in Italy, where today this land is known as Lazio. The true spelling of this, the true Latin spelling of Lazio would be Latio or Laetio. You will find both of them. Laetio is interpreted as Laeti, and that again would be a land of a marshland. And those who know what I'm talking about, those who know what Lazio is, what where Rome is built, they know that that's ancient region is known in Italy as Paludi Pontini. That's a marsh, a very big marsh. One of the names of Ptolemy names in Spain is spelled obviously with a mistake. Erotani, in fact, should have been spelled, I suppose, as Oretani. He misplaced two vowels in these names. These names, because only that way it coincides with the very famous place of. Very famous archaeological monument in, connected with the Iberian culture, which is called Oreto. It's located south to the Ciudad Real, very close to the Granatula de Calatrava, the native town of Pedro Almodóvar, by the way. And from Georgian point of view, the word Oreti is perfectly translated as land of two, because Ori in Georgian language means two. We already know that. Oh, again, when I went there, I was sure that I will find some two objects around Oreto, which would justify the presence of the name two of the word two in the name of this land. And when I came there, this was what I saw. Actually, the site is located right between two hills. They are not really tall, but they definitely stick out on the local terrain, and you understand that. Well, first of all, they could have been higher in ancient times. We see that the land around them has been tilled, and we can imagine that definitely those two objects, natural objects, could have been used as something to associate, to connect the name of the people who lived there, the name of the local land, the name of the local country with two hills. Oreto, that would be something that lies between the two hills. By the way, in Georgia you have a toponym with virtually the same name, Oreto. That's a name of a lake in the region of Tusheti. And now, obviously, the most mysterious part of the history of Spain, which, as the project between two Iberias, claims, is not a mystery anymore. I'm talking about Tartes. Mythical city mentioned for the first time, obviously for the only time, by Herodotus. He speaks about when he spoke about the south of Spain, when he spoke about the Betis River, when he spoke about the Argentonian king, and when he spoke about the travels of Phoenicians and Greeks to the remote land. So ever since, people for 2.5 millennia as of now, they have been trying to establish the right location of the city, but failed. Before we try to do something about the name of Tartes, we need to remember one important, I would call it an axiom, a historical linguistic axiom. Before you start talking about any on any topic related to historical linguistics, you should always begin with mentioning some virtually mathematic things that should be taken into account before you start doing anything about etymology, about ancient etymology. Now I'm talking about necessity to take into account the difference between two main ancient Greek dialects. We remember that they differ slightly. The Attic dialect, for example, where the Attic dialect uses the consonant T, Ionic dialect uses the consonant S. That's exactly the reason why we know the some Greek words in two versions, in two interpretations. For example, four would be both tetara, that would be Attic, and tessara, that would be Ionic. Talata, C, would be in Attic, talassa would be in Ionic. Glotta, language, would be in that would be Attic. Glossa, that would be Ionic, and they have more. So we have a totally legitimate right, I would call it even an obligation, to interpret the consonant S in Greek suffixes, to interpret it as possible T. Both variants cannot be right, only one of them is right, so we need to choose which one exactly is the genuine one. So I claim, I insist that the Attic dialect from this point of view is more genuine, which enables us to read such geographic names as, for example, Tartessos, that's the Greek name of this word, in a new way. So, well, first of all, we get rid of the os ending, which is a nominative case ending in Greek language. We don't need it for our analysis, for our morphological analysis. And we are left with actually what this city is known as, Tartes. And given this difference between two Greek dialects, we have a right to replace S with T, and we are left, so we are left with Tartet, with, if you want to make it sound more Georgian, you can add the Georgian nominative case ending, that would be E, and you will end up with having Tarteti, land of Tarti. What is Tarti? Tarti is sturgeon, actually Stella sturgeon, but it doesn't matter, the species may be any. I don't think people knew how to tell this narrowly, sturgeons between them. So let's call it just sturgeon. Were there any sturgeons in those times, in those lands, in those waters, more exactly? Sure. We can find information about a sturgeon meat used to cook salads in by Phoenicians in ancient times around Cadiz, modern Spanish Cadiz. That's a well-known fact. I personally myself went to Sanlúcar de Barrameda. That's exactly where Guadalquivir River, former Betis, flows into the Atlantic Ocean. And I asked local fishermen about the sturgeon. Yes, they said the sturgeon finally returned to the local waters after a very, very, very long absence. And we can find the confirmation in at least two articles, which you can find on internet. The sturgeons of Guadalquivir have returned. Or this one, it has a link. Again, it says that after a long period of the absence, sturgeons return to the local waters. So the word Tarteti finally means land of Tarti, land of sturgeon. Yes, there used to be, and still is, there still is sturgeon in the both in the local, in the river Guadalquivir and in the local Atlantic waters. And now you have a right to assume that the name of Turdetani and Turduli, both of them look extremely Georgian, that you can find on the map of Ptolemy, in fact, may be a little bit crooked root Tarti, not Turdi. Turdetani, that would be Tartetani. Turduli, that would be Tartuli. Both of them would mean sturgeon. And while Tardetani are placed exactly on the Guadalquivir River by Ptolemy, another tribe called Turduli, that would be Tartuli, that will be an adjective made out of the Tarti Georgian word meaning sturgeon. This tribe is placed by Ptolemy on another river, which is called Guadiana, and which also flows into the Atlantic Ocean, and which also used to be and still has sturgeon in it. So, Tartes is the land of sturgeon. We will later see that the same Georgian word, Tarti, should be used to interpret another important, very Kartvelian toponym, Tartar, but this time in another part of the world. Another axiom, another very, very basic knowledge that you, anyone, now you see that if you don't have at least surface knowledge about the Georgian morphology, you are no linguist. Actually, you are no historian. Sorry to say that, but it's true. So another thing that you are obliged to know is that many Georgian toponyms are used with the help of the sa prefix. These are abstract nouns. Actually, you should also add an e ending to such construction to make it perfect, but from sometimes this ending may be different or even omitted. The most important thing would be the sa prefix, which is a, first of all, it's a prefix. Now you know that it lets you to get to the real root of the word for your analysis. And second, you know that it's a very, very typical abstract construction, which means place of the root, which it is added to, where the root is. For example, if tsheni in Georgian language means horse, then satshene in Georgian means place of horses. That may be a stable. That is actually a name of a village where they breed horses, as I imagine. If garlic in Georgian language is niori, that saniore would be place of garlic. That's a name of another village in Georgia, really existing. And there are many more examples like that. So we may assume that now we have a right or even an obligation to assume that those European world toponym that start with sa, in fact, start with a prefix. We never knew it could be a prefix, but now we know, and thus we can get to the real root. In Spain, there is a very, very bright example of two small towns, Sasamon and Sasuar. The fact that the second starts with Z should not confuse you in Spanish language. They are legitimately interchangeable. So these two small towns lay around the city of Burgos, 200 kilometers between each other. And the interpretation of the roots is astounding. So with sa taken out in both cases, we are left with Samoni and Suari. in one of rare dictionaries that you can find on the net, rare dictionaries of Georgian language, you will find that the word samoni means sukani, which is a fat, thick person. While, again, quite a rare word in this that can be found only in the dictionary of Niko Chubinashvili, that's the dictionary of 19th century. The word swari means slander. Thus, in on quite the same territory, you find a land, a city, a place of fat people and place of slander people. Sa samone, sa suare, with final vowels eventually taken off. Now you can imagine that these two places were named by some same people, comparing them, and these names were given those who spoke Kartvelian languages. What province is the city of Saragossa a capital of? It's the province of Aragon, or Aragó if in Catalan. Do you know that the word Saragossa in fact contains the name of the province it is a capital of? You can see it, that Saragossa does contain the word Aragó. But how can you take this word Aragó out of the word Saragossa? Only if you keep in mind that the word starts with the prefix. Spanish people, even Basque people, never knew that Saragossa could have started with the prefix, and for that reason, they never thought that we have such a right to split it into those morphemes. But we do, once we consider it a Kartvelian construction, the starting prefix is taken out easily. Yes, sure, we should have had two A's, though, but two A's is a strange combination. Two A's always will merge into one, so it's a standard tendency all over the world, so it's not a problem. And thus, you will see that Saragossa would mean where Aragó is. While we know that Aragó, besides being a province, actually also is a river. The final sa also shouldn't bother you, because that's a typical indirect case ending in Kartvelian languages. But we get back to the place around Burgos, a little bit further from Burgos than Sasamon is. There is another city called Sahagún. Actually, it's even a clearer construction, because we see that the H letter is used here as a split between prefix which ends with A and a root which starts with A. So, in order not to let them merge as it was done in the case of Saragossa, they split it with a mute H. The H is mute in the Spanish language. Sahagún, that's a city that may be now interpreted as the land of Agún, or more exactly, land of Aguna, an ancient god of winery in the western ancient western Georgia. That's a well-known fact, well-known name. Thus, that would be a land of Aguna, and to get persuaded that it actually is like that, we need to make sure that Sahagún has anything to do with the winery. And that's the page on internet where you can find Sahagún described as one of the cradles of Spanish winemaking. So that is exactly the reason why it was called that way with a Georgian name. Two more interesting tribes names on the map of Ptolemy, of map of Spain of Ptolemy. You should remember that's not exactly the map that Ptolemy drew himself. That's the map was drawn 14th or 15th century, but strictly according to the coordinates that Ptolemy did mention in his atlas, which he compiled in the 2nd century. So this information is from the 2nd century. And in the 2nd century, we find two Iberian tribes in Spain. That would be Arawaki and Waki. We may assume that they contain the same root, that would be Vak, and the difference is the presence of the R prefix in the second name, which, as we already know, is the fundamental Georgian negative prefix, meaning no or not. So if one of the tribes is called Vaki, their neighbors logically may have been called not Vaki, and in this case they should have been added a negative prefix. In fact, it is like that. The prefix is added, the prefix is Georgian, is Kartvelian, and the root that follows it looks very similar to the same root used in the name Vaki. Aravaki and Vaki. And that's not all. The word Vaki, in fact, also looks very, very Megrelian for this specific ending A, which in Megrelian language is, the Megrelian language, Megrelian dictionary shows clear tendency of omitting many consonants, thus making the language sound more with more voice, with more vowels, quite an opposite tendency compared to the Georgian language. Well, it's very typical for Megrelian dictionary, most often these consonants are taken out of the suffixes like R or L or R or AL. So these consonants R and L are taken out in those words. So we may assume that the word Vaki, in fact, used to be the adjective Vakeli, which is formed out of the word Vake. Vake is a fundamental Georgian word for valley, flat open space between hills. And from it, Vakeli would be a dweller of such a valley, which is a perfect word to call a tribe with. That's interesting too, because first the word Gavarda means kind of a plant in the Spanish language, while at the same time we find a city of Gavarda in about 30 kilometers south to Valencia, and we find Gabardua as a Georgian Masdar, blocking path with undergrowth, so having clear relation to plants as well. But the most interesting is that this toponym Gavarda exists as a root of a totally really existing Georgian surname of Gavardashvili. You should know, if you don't, that Shvili ending means born, born to or born at. It may be either, but the fact that the root of this Georgian name actually is a name of Spanish city, it impresses. In the dictionary of Moroccan Arabic, you can find an alternative spelling of the city, of the name of the city of Granada. That would be Gernata. It's should be interpreted as should be considered a genuine spelling of this name because it looks totally almost impeccable Kartvelian construction. Gernata or Gernati with a more Kartvelian ending contains the suffix at, which is, according to the etymological dictionary of Kartvelian languages compiled of Mr. Klimov, which is a Megrelian and Laz equivalent of that Georgian at suffix that had already been mentioned many times. So Gernati we have a right to interpret it a little bit in Georgian way. That would be Gerneti, and that would be land of Gerni. In its turn, the word Gerni is an old Georgian plural form, which is formed with the help of N suffix, plural form of the noun Geri, which in Megrelian language means the same as Mgeli in Georgian. In Georgian, it means wolf. So Geri, wolf, Gerni, wolves, and Gerneti, Gernati, that will be land of wolves. That is what Granada actually is. And you should know that this exactly place is the very center of the habitat of the famous Iberian wolf. Huelva, that's the name of a south Spanish city located in Andalusia. Totally corresponds to the Megrelian Masdar Huelva. Even O here may be soft, because in Megrelian language it's quite soft, like in Spanish language or in French language, Huelva. That would be Huelva and Huelva, those are two same words. Huelva in Megrelian language means shining, brilliance. How could a city or a toponym be given such a name is totally understood from the name of the coast where Spanish Huelva is located. The name of the coast is Costa del Sol, coast of sun. We already spoke about the significance of fish name for the history of Spain, that was deciphering of Tartes toponym. And we also can find more examples of like that. For example, Spanish Murcia, which if you would ask anybody to read this name from the early Latin point of view, that would be exactly Murza, where you should remember that the Latin C initially used to render C sound, which does not exist in most European languages, but which is very fundamental for languages of other family, first of all for the Kartvelian family. So, in the Georgian dictionary of Ariane Centuria, you can find the word Murza, meaning barbel. That's the name of a fish that you definitely and easily will find in the river of Segura that flows across Murcia, the Murcia city. And the name of the of this local species is Barbo Gitano. It is well known there. And the most impressive would be that this fish not only lives in the river of Segura, but also that in the very center of the city, right in the water of the river, there is a monument to this same fish. They don't know, the Murcians themselves, they don't know that that's a monument to the fish that gave the name to the city, because they don't know this Georgian word. They don't know, they have no reason to think that Spanish toponyms, first of all, should be and always should be interpreted from the Kartvelian point of view. For the same reason, we can draw some parallels between Tarragona, which is, again, a Stella sturgeon, some other species It's not tarty. It's well, this is in this dictionary. It means the same as the tarty means, but in fact, it's a little bit different species. And we can connect it with the name of Tarragona, another famous Spanish city. That's a resemblance. This is not the totally morphological coincidence. Well, the method, the main method of the project between two Iberias is morphological analysis. So resemblance is not the the very core findings of the project. The very core findings, as you have already seen, are is the presence of various morphemes, prefixes, suffixes, roots combined in strict morphological constructions, typical for Kartvelian languages, but found all over the world. This is what is the core method of the of our project. In Swan language, in the dictionary of Carpes Dondua, you can find the root pomp, which means to have to be very leafy, description of a tree. That may be, and I'm sure it is, a true etymology for the name of Pamplona, because this very important Basque city has a different spelling. It's spelled not with A, but with O. That would be Pamplona. Ona is a very typical Kartvelian toponymic ending, while L is a very, very fundamental Kartvelian Kartvelian suffix, with the help of which you form adjectives out of nouns. So, Pamplona, in this case, that would mean something that has many trees, many leaves, many forests, something like that. One of the most mysterious names is the name of a ancient tribe of Beri that you can find all over Spain and even in France. In France, you know there is a city of Auvergne, which comes from the name ancient name Arverni, which is not Verni, as we already know, and Verni we can interpret it as Berni as well for the fact that Spanish and Greek B and V are in fact may represent the same sound, and Berni we can split it into Beri and the Georgian plural suffix N. So that would be that was what we take out of Auvergne toponym. At the same time, Bernedo, Spanish Bernedo is in fact Berneti. It used to be spelled in medieval texts like that, which is land of Berni, which again is Beri plus plural suffix. The suburb of Pamplona is called Beriain, which is should be interpreted as Spanish Beriani, which again is a totally Kartvelian adjective of Beri. Tribe of Beroni, placed by Pliny in in the same territory of the northern Spain, again from the Castilian point, should and can be interpreted as bear-like. The capital is Oluba. This is very, very important, but we will talk about that later. In Albania, we see a city of Berat, which is again, a Migrelian toponymic construction, a land of Beri. And also, I'm not mentioning it here, but also there are reasons to consider that Berbers, in fact, bear the same root and belong to the same nation of Beri. In a Georgian language, Beri means old. It does not, maybe it does not explain it 100%, but we can imagine a tribe having such a name, because in Ukraine, in ancient Ukraine, we have a tribe called Drevliani, and in fact, it should and can be interpreted as the ancient people. Many Spanish toponyms start with Guadal, and people it's like Guadalquivir, Guadalajara, Guadalcanal, etc. And Spanish etymologists are sure that that's an Arabic word. I claim it's not such, because in Magrelian language we have Guadali word, which means slow and lazy movement. Exactly, that's a perfect description, for example, for the movement of the waters in the Betis River, which is Guadalquivir. Now, let's talk about the names of several famous Spanish provinces. And we start with Asturias, which, as we are told by the etymologist, it comes from the name of the ancient river Astura, which today bears the name of Esla. Well, first of all, Asturi, again, that's a typical Georgian adjective, which is derived from root. And we see that Astavs, that's a verb form, in Georgian dictionary means spins, means spinning, while, and we know that it comes from the fundamental stwa, masdar, meaning the same, meaning spinning. The same Spanish etymologists insist that the word Astura has its kin in Britain, where we can find a river called Stour, and it makes sense, because Stour, that would be again a Georgian adjective made out of the same stwa, masdar, meaning spinning. So what kind of spinning can you associate with rivers? Again, those are whirlpools. So, and we find the confirmation of that, Rio Esla, which used to be the ancient Astura. In fact, in the place called Salto de Molino, there is a site abundant with whirlpools. We already spoke about Andalusia etymology, true etymology, and we agreed, I hope, that in fact it's not Andalus but Pandalus, which is the which should be translated, interpreted from the Basque point of view as a wide valley, which Andalusia in fact is. Cantabria, another famous province located next to Asturias, the word Cantabres has an alternative spelling in medieval text sources, that would be Cantebres. And in this case, we can see a clear and very fundamental Georgian ebr suffix here, which means like, similar. So Cantabre, that would be similar to Cant. Sorry to say that, similar to something known as Kanti in ancient Georgian language. We don't see that direct this root in its pure form in the Georgian dictionary, but we do see clear derivation of it. That's an adjective, Kantieli. Definitely made out of the root canti. Cantieli, that would be reckless and imprudent. Ebur, that's, as you see, a suffix translated as like. So those who know Spanish history, they remember that Cantabre tribe is attested exactly as reckless and imprudent. This one is killing. I was left speechless for an hour when I stumbled across this word in Georgian dictionary of Ariane Centuria. Ariane Centuria tells us that in Georgian language, the word portohali means orange. You have no other option but to agree that Portugal and Portugal is and should be and is one same word. Why is Portugal, why is Portugal associated with oranges is clear from this quote, which says that the whole species of orange known as sweet orange or genuine orange is also known as Portuguese orange. I didn't know that. Now I do, and now I understand that the association between this country of Portugal and oranges is absolutely logical and strong. And in Georgian language, we see that the word orange is called with the name Portohali. We may assume that it may have been borrowed from the name of the fruit, may have been borrowed from the name of the country where it is grown, but it is not so. It is absolutely astonishing and impressive. The word Portohali, the Georgian word Portohali, consists of two different morphemes, which explain why this fruit was called that with that name in Georgian language. Pore, and you see that below, that's a variety of quince, and we will use that same Georgian word fore to interpret the name of Russian name of the of trout, which is forel. And you should know that this pore, a variety of quince, for Georgian people used to be, now we understand that, for Georgian people it used to be the maybe the only source for natural orange color. So anything that was of orange color, like the meat of trout, sea trout, not the river trout, which is red, which is orange, is and should be associated from Kartvelian Georgian point of view with this variety of quince. You should know that quince, I have never seen this variety of quince called fore, but I and I don't know what color it has, but I do know that once you make jam out of quince, the jam is extremely orange, has very very bright a very typical orange color. So that would be por, which means orange color, tohali, and tohali or tohli, you can see that the A may be omitted, that's a fundamental Georgian word, means nosh, grab, food. They claim that it's a borrowing from Jewish language. No way. Tohli, that's a typical Georgian derivation from the word tohi, which means hoe, mattock. So tohali, that would be something which is hoed, something which is mattocked, something which is taken out of the land with the help of mattock to eat. That's what a tohli or tohali, which technically is a passive participle, which, as I told you already, is a should better be called a passive verbal adjective. And we see eventually that the word portohali, in fact, means food of orange color. That's exactly what orange is, and it has no connection with the name of Portugal. I mean, no, the word Portugal cannot be considered, we see that, cannot be considered as a source for borrowing for this Georgian word. Vice versa, the name of Portugal comes from this Georgian word Portohali, meaning orange fruit. A food of orange color. That's, isn't that amazing? You need to know that. What about Spain, or as they call it, España, in Spain itself? Yeah, España is not a good word. They, you know that Spanish people tend to add the vowel at the beginning of the word, starting with sp and st. For that same reason, statistics would be estadística, scheme would be esquema, etc. For that same reason, we have a right to get rid of that starting vowel in the Spain name and agree that Spain, which is an English name, is much more exact from the for etymological purposes. Or even better, we should take the Italian the Italian word under which the country of Spain is known. That would be exactly Spagna. The final A is, according to the etymological dictionary of Kartvelian languages compiled by Klimov, a final A, as well as starting A in Georgian, in Kartvelian languages, used to be a demonstrative pronoun, which is, maybe if you know about that, demonstrative pronoun is nothing else than a definite article. Or actually, what is definite article? That's a demonstrative pronoun. That's the essence of this part of speech, which in fact is just a duplication of the function of the demonstrative pronoun. So, final A still is still used in Basque language as the definite article, by the way. So, in order to be able to interpret the word España, we should take the final A out, and we are left with the word España, which is totally Kartvelian, old Kartvelian construction, old Kartvelian plural form of the word spa. Spa means army, host of soldiers. So that would be Spanya. If spa is an army, Spanya would be several armies. And obviously, that's what this name means. What about Iberians? Where does this word come from, and what does it mean? We may assume, in fact, it had been being assumed long ago, that this name Iberian contains the same root that we can find, we can see in the Basque word of Ibar, which means a valley. Valley is a place of river, which is a place of water. Ibar, technically, is a totally Kartvelian, which is Svan, construction ending with the Svan, the most trademark Svan plural form suffix, which is also a very toponymic suffix in Svan language. Hence, we may assume, and that's exactly what I did, that the word Basque, word Ibar, which in fact is a Svan word, means place of Ib, place of the root Ib, whatever it means. And since the valley is a place of water, I assumed that we should find the word Ib, the root Ib, in any of its form, in Kartvelian languages, in Basque language, as something that has any connection to water. In fact, it turned out to be so, exactly so, because in the dictionary of Koldo Michelena, that's the Basque language dictionary, you will find the word Ibai, meaning exactly river, while the word Ibi, which is a definite relative of the word Ibai, you will see that it's, in French language, it means small stream, or small or spring of water. Again, an absolutely direct connection to water. So our first initial assumption that Ibar should be a place of water found its confirmation, its total confirmation. And now we move on to the Kartvelian language family, and we see a word Iba in the Migrelian language, meaning the same as Ube in Georgian language. While in Georgian language, Ube, among other things, means a bay. Again, quite an amount of water. So, Iberians or Ibers, or whatever you pronounce them, Iberos, if in Spain, Iberi, if in Georgian, that would be somebody related to water. So I assume that that's a name for valley dwellers, people who lived, used to live along rivers. And we find this confirmation all over the world, because anywhere that we will encounter the same root Iber, we will see that it always will be having direct relations to rivers. This is what Iberian is. Those were toponyms. Now to ordinary words. We start with the conjunction AND, which in Spanish language sounds as you know, sounds as E, coincides with the same conjunction in Russian language, which is E again, and also in Swan language, where it again is E. In a Swan language, the word AL, which is a derivation of the ancient ALE, used to be a demonstrative pronoun, which means exactly a definite article. And we see that it coincides totally with the Arabic definite article, which is also AL, and which may be the source, or may have been considered for all those times a derivation, a source for the L article in Spanish language. Now we see that it's not Arabic, it's Swan, which is Kartvelian. In Spanish language, the indirect form of the personal pronoun yo, which is I, would be me. In Georgian language, me means I, yo. Ak in Georgian means here, aki in Spanish means here. The Georgian word amo, meaning pleasant, pleasing, serves as a source for two fundamental Spanish and Latin words, like amor, and which is love, and amigo, which is friend. But if you add a negative prefix ar to this same root ami, you obtain immediately a word with the opposite meaning, not pleasing. And as you see, you have a right to omit the vowel, the a vowel, and you are left with army, which is something definitely connected with unpleasant stuff. Magic word nateli or natli, which in Georgian means light, serves as a source for the whole family of Latin, Spanish, English words. First of all, note that sanati would be an Georgian abstract noun meaning lamp, light. It's derived from nateli, a noun. And in its turn, santeli would be a derivation from sanati. Santeli means candle. Santeli, santli, is very, very similar to what candle and candela in Spanish is. The starting consonant s has a right to be associated with the Latin c, because at the very beginning Latin c used to represent quite a bunch of different words, different sounds, including s. Ponwa, that's a masdar, Megrelian word, which has pon as a root, and means leaning or propping. That's exactly the same root as in the Spanish verb poner, which means to put. Tir, that means to draw, to pull, and that's the same root as in the Spanish verb tirar, which means the same. To pull. Hodwa, which means sexual intercourse in Megrelian language, is the same word, the same root that as Spaniards using the word hoder, which means the same thing. Hod and hod, the correspondence is total. Quit in Swan language means thief, while kitar, which is spelled through Q-U-I-T, that would be to rob in Spanish language. Sikhwaruli, that is love in that's a very difficult construction, meaning love in Georgian language, and the root here would be kwar, while in Spanish language love or to love would be querer, where the root is care, kwar y care, which is spelled through qu. That is a definite correspondence. Rbeva, that's ravaging, among other things, in Georgian language. The root here is rbu, which is robar in Spanish language, which means the same. To rob, to ravage, to rob. Bib, that's to pour or to spill. And we see that that's a clear source for bibere, Latin verb bibere, and Spanish verb beber, which means to drink. That's bib, that's a Swan word. Manda in Swan language means a wish, a will. And from here we have the Spanish word mandar, which means to command. Eswa means, as we see, to be born to somebody. That's a masdar ending with the masdar ending wa and having s as a root. That would be the same root as in the Latin fundamental verb essere, which means to be. And from here we have various forms like s in the Spanish language or is in the English language. It also comes from here. Muchi, that's a handful, which means not one thing, but just a handful, much. That's again mucho in Spanish language and much in English. In Spanish language, abedul means birch tree. And if we assume, which we should, that abedul is the Kartvelian adjective abeduli, we should agree that it's formed out of abedi, noun, which we find in the Georgian dictionary, exactly the word abedi, meaning tinder or touch wood. Tinder fungus, and we should know that birch tree is famous exactly for having this kind of fungus on themselves. In particular, in Russian language, such a fungus which lives on the on trees is known as the birch fungus, березовый гриб. Agia, that's an old Migrelian construction, means is spread out, while the Spanish eagle, águila, definitely may be interpreted as the Georgian verbal adjective made out of this same root agi and il as a verbal adjective suffix. So águila in this case would be exactly something which is spread out, and eagle is something which is definitely spread out. His wings. Anybody who starts doing paying attention to the similarities between Georgian language and European languages, first of all, comes across the hairy word, Georgian word meaning air. Definitely hairy and air or aire, since we are talking now about Spanish words, that's the same thing. Well, the question is, who borrowed from whom? For centuries, Georgians themselves had been persuaded that, of course, the direction is to the Georgian language, not from it. But it's not so, because we see that the same dictionary of Ariane Centuria enlists a word hawa, meaning weather, climate. And this The word "hairy" definitely is an adjective made out of the "ha" root and the masdar "hawa" ending with the masdar ending definitely contains the same "ha" root. So the words are definitely relatives, and since we have since the same root is present in different word in the Georgian language, we understand that the root itself is Georgian, it was not borrowed from anywhere. So haeri is another Georgian word used all over the world. That's a poplar tree, which in Spain is alamo. Alamo or alami should be interpreted as a typical Migrelian adjective with the typical Migrelian adjective suffix am, made out of the root ali. Ali means flame, that hence the word alami, Migrelian word alami, and later Spanish alamo would be flamey. Why is it flamey? Because when in autumn poplars look like that, they look red, which is the color of flame also. The suffix, or the word angi means similar or like in Migrelian language, and that gives us a new way to look at many both Georgian words like perangi, durangi, lumbangi, nardangi, and Spanish words like patango, bitango, pachango, fandango, tamango, etc. Most of those examples, the root to which this suffix is added also interprets from the Kartvelian point of view. For example, tamango, that's kind of trousers, while the word tami in Georgian language means part of a leg. Azum in Georgian language means exactly the same that what asim means in Portuguese language, so much. So the similarity is clear. In Spanish, well, in Vicena, well, it's spelled with two L's. In some parts of Spain, it's pronounced as Baliena. So, and we see that it comes from the Georgian word palene, which means absolutely the same, well. On the map of Ptolemy, we didn't mention two more tribes, Bastitani and Bastuli, two clear Georgian toponymic constructions with Basti as the root. The word Basti is not present in Georgian languages, but we have a very interesting adjective Bastaneli, meaning very old, ancient. So we can imagine that the name of Bastitani and Bastuli, those Iberian tribes in Spain, are connected somehow to this meaning of this Georgian word. Libre in Swan language means to reduce. Li here is a prefix. Prefix of the infinitive, of the Swan infinitive, bre is a root. That would be the same, and we see the confirmation, the masdar bra in the Georgian language meaning deducting. From here, the Spanish word breve, which means brief in English. Kachwa in Georgian means moving or axing, while kachar in Spanish language means to chop with the axe. Kalandrosi, that's interesting, that would be lark. You see that these Georgian words, first of all, it coincides with the Spanish calandria, which means a kind of a lark. That's a total parallel, but it has an additional twist. You can see that the word kalandrosi hides in it another word, alandro, inside, while in Spanish language, lark would be alondra. nice to see that. Nice to notice that. Chucky, that would be coward in English language, while jackal, which is chacal in Spanish language, and chacal, that's a clear Georgian adjective made out of the chaki root, and we see while this animal was called it that way. Chaki, coward, chacal, chacali, that would be cowardly. Chaval, that's famous word for a young man in Spanish language. It may also be as exist in alternative form of chabón, so it may be chav, may be chab. So we have a right to look for a chab root in Georgian language, and we find chabuki, uki, that's a diminutive suffix meaning young man. Chabuki altogether meaning young man. Chungo is difficult, unpleasant, etc. Difficult, first of all, in the Spanish language. While chungali, which has chung as a root, is a barely audible sound in Georgian language, which is close to difficult. Cincel in Spanish language, that's a kind of instrument used to carve stones. While you carve stones, definitely you have lots of sparks. Cincel, which has the same root as the Spanish word, in Georgian language, cinceli means exactly spark. Cor means cabbage in Spanish language, and it comes from caulis, Latin caulis, where we see the presence of w sound. And in Georgian language, cauli is exactly stalk leaves of beet, radish, etc., which is very close to what cabbage is. This one is incredible. Spanish coño is in Spanish, it's a bad word. In Cuba, they use it without knowing its meaning in Spanish, what it means in Spain. Actually, the word coño means vagina. And we see that in Georgian language, coño means hemlock. Hemlock is something which has a very, very bad, even musty smell. And here we see what somebody asks about the smell of this female genitals. The smell is musty, again, the same smell as the smell of that plant, which is which has in Georgian language the same meaning as vagina in Spanish language. Cope, that would be a ladle for measuring wine, that's copa, which is cup in Spanish language. Cor, that would be a door in Swan language, and corral, that would be the same in Swan language. Corral, that's a place where the cattle is kept in Spanish language. Closed by the door, obviously. Cru, that's desolate, bleak, that would be the same root as we use in Spanish cruel, Spanish and English cruel. Unbelievable. In Serbian language, donde means until, till or until. In Spanish language, donde means where. In Serbian language, do, and in any Slavic language, do means till, until. While nde may be the same post position as in Georgian language, where it is in the form of md, and it means until, exactly until. And we know that md and nd in Migrana language are interchangeable, and here is an proof of that, so that the whole story gets absolutely tangled, but very, very, very interesting. Puti, that's smoke in Georgian language. Again, you should remember that In Georgian language, there is no f sound. In any kind of Kartvelian languages contain this sound. In ancient Greek sounds, yes, we have the phi letter, but in ancient Greek, the phi letter wasn't phi. It didn't represent the f sound. It represented the same p sound, p, very aspirated, p, for which we use this Georgian letter party. So that would be, but that means, again, that's the reason why we spell the word, such word as photograph with PH and many other words as well, because F and P aspirated, actually we should consider them as the same sound. Well, and that's the reason why we should compare the Latin, English, Spanish word future, futuro, that would be in Spanish. We should interpret it as a Georgian, possible Georgian adjective ending with the trademark ur, Georgian ur suffix, that would be futuri. Futuri, that should be puturi, because f and p, that's the, as I told you, is the same sound. And puti, that would be smoke. So, puturi, futuro, future, literally means smoky. What is there so smoky about future? Why is future associated with smoke? Because one of the most popular way to foretell used to be to foretell looking at smoke. That's why you foretell future. You do it by with the help of smoke. That's why future is associated with smoke. And in fact, morphologically, it's totally Georgian adjective futuri, containing the adjective root puti, which is smoke. Gaguiar, that's a rare Spanish word meaning to spread, to creep, to crawl. Gaheba in Georgian language means finding one's way, which is spreading. Gandinga means what is left after you wash the ore, while Gandineba in Georgian means going, flowing out. Gangero means somebody who is looking for easy ways to earn money, while Gangioba in Georgian language is exactly venturing too far. Gazapo, and this Z sound is used was used in Spanish language to represent exactly the non-existent today Ts sound. That means a trickster, which while Gazapo in Georgian language means practicing, training, become skill. What about the famous Spanish word gente, which means people? It also may come from the Castellan family, where we find the word genturi with this fricative he. Georgian language has two he, plosive and fricative. Genturi, that means roaming. From here, since genturi technically is an adjective, we can extrapolate the non-existent already gent or genti root in the meaning of the one who roams, which is people. Gili in Swan language means stupid, while Gil, which is spelled with G, starting G, means exactly the same. Gil means stupid in Spanish language. You remember when, there is a legend, I'm not sure that's a scientific etymology, but there is a legend that when Cook or anybody else came to Australia for the first time, and he wanted to know the name of the local animal, and he asked the local people, who's that? And the answer was kangaroo. which, as they say in the local language, meant I don't understand what they're asking me. While Cook interpreted as a concrete answer to the concrete question, and since then we have been calling this animal as kangaroo without understanding what it meant originally. Maybe something similar happened in Spain, ancient Spain, which was not Spain yet, which was Iberia, Kartvelian speaking Iberia, with the Roman people coming, other people coming, etc., a mixture of languages. Quite possible to imagine people didn't understand each other well. So, in Spanish language, guinda means cherry. While in Georgian language, guinda means you want, or do you want, if asked with the interrogative intonation. So we can imagine that a seller of cherries offers it to a stranger and says guinda in Georgian Kartvelian language, meaning do you want, while the stranger, whoever he is, actually later he's supposed to become a Spaniard, thinks that the seller says the name of the fruit and mentions this fruit under this name in the Spanish dictionary. A possibility. Quera, that's hearth, that's fireplace, that's definitely that's a source for ceramics in all the languages. In Spanish language, cotorra means magpie, a bird, small bird, quite small bird. We understand that it's small because it's cotorra, that would be Mingrelian equivalent of the possible Georgian adjective coturi, made out of a cot or coto or coti root. Coto in Mingrelian language means the same as cotani, that's a pot, clay pot we used to cook food. For that reason, we understand that cotorra or cotori or coturi, that would be a name for a bird small enough to be placed in that coto pot. This suits better the English language chapter. In Spanish, crocodile would be cocodrilo, but that's the same word. And in the Georgian language, crocoto means colored or colorful. So, while eel, as I mentioned, that's the verbal adjective suffix. So that would be, if we consider crocodile skin colored and colorful, that would be natural to call it that with this word. Another thing that everybody sees right away upon just starting, having started to analyze, to compare a Georgian vocabulary and European languages vocabulary, he sees that the word lexi in Georgian language means the same as it means in Greek language. Lexos, that would be word. Who stole from whom? The Georgians themselves have been believing firmly that they stole it. They stole it from the poor Greeks. Now we have all the reasons to believe that it was not so, because you need to have some knowledge about, some feeling about Swan language, which were starting le. Is very typical for forming verbs or verb forms. For example, we can find in the dictionary of Aslan Lipartelian, another good dictionary in Swan language, we will find leekf, meaning tqua, which is meaning to speak, to say. And this word contains exactly le, starting le is a prefix here. If we assume that in the word lexi, le is also starting prefix, we are left with the root x, and we need to interpret it now from the Kartvelian point of view. And that's very easy because we can easily find two masdars, ksua and ksowa, which both contain this exact root in question, which is ks, and it means spinning, weaving. So what is a speech or saying if not the weaving of words? That would be the reason, the explanation how the word weaving eventually found itself as the root for the word meaning word, with the swan prefix added at the beginning. Liebre, that's the name for hare in an animal in Spanish language, and it comes, and they claim it comes from the Latin leporis, which is lepori, which would be again a Mingrelian adjective made out of the lepi noun. We have this noun lepi meaning spittle or phlegm. What about saliva? What about has saliva? Why was this animal associated with such a strange thing? It's not strange because we found a confirmation of the importance of has a spittle, which in the 17th century was recommended by an English physician for women who wanted to conceive. They need to consume has spittle. That's why this animal was associated with this. Such a strange but reliable and legitimate etymology. Loco. In Chile, it means a type of mussel. And in Georgian language, it means catfish. So catfish is a fish, but not only. It also the same as cuttlefish, which is a mussel. And hence, we see that the word means the same thing both in Spanish language and in Georgian. Marili, that is salt in Georgian language, very fundamental thing, and clearly an adjective, verbal adjective or participle formed out of the mar. Now, mar, that is sea in Spanish language, and salt, it is actually the source for salt. It has been the source for salt in all the times. Rare Spanish words, mojarache, it starts with mo, which is personificating prefix in Georgian language, with the help of which we construct words meaning people, doer of actions, representatives of professions, etc. So in this case, we see that mojarache is actually a clown, while jarache is a scaffolding. At the same time, jarachueli in a dialect of Racha dialect of Georgian language means a little ringed plover, which is a bird, and it may be some kind of a mockingbird connected with the concept of clown. Mojatrar, again, something that seems quite Georgian. It means to deceive, and mojatreba is diffidence in English language, while diffidence is the same as distrust, which is very close to the concept of cheating. Morigerar, that would be to control the excess of the sentiments in your actions in Spanish language, and in it definitely comes from the Georgian morige, which means duty, which is very close to what I have just said about the meaning of the morigerar word. That's one of the best. Muchacho, which is a boy, muchacha is a girl, previously used to, in the ancient Spanish language, used to be mochacho, not muchacho. And mo, as we already know, that's a formant of a doer of some action in Georgian language. The action should be chach, chachua, which exists in Migrela language and means the same as chochua in Georgian language, while chochua means crawling. That's mochacho, is somebody that crawls, is a crawler, which is a baby. Spanish people never knew about that, never even suspected that it could be something like that. That's interesting. Mundo, that means world in Spanish language. Mundi, that means buttocks in Migrelian language. While the same thing, which means back, buttocks or back in Georgian language, which is zurgi, unexpectedly shows such a wonderful expression as Dedamitsis Zurgi, that would be Dedamitsis Mundi as well. The face of the earth, this world. That's how buttocks or back, the concepts of buttocks of a back is connected with the concept of the world, and it's done through the Kartvelian language family. Navaja, that would be a knife in Spanish language. Navaki, that's small arrow in Georgian language. Nave, that would be a ship in Spanish language. Navi, that would be a boat in Georgian language. And the word is definitely Kartvelian. The word noche, that which is night in Spanish language, you may believe it or not, it's only a part of what was left from the nochueri verbal adjective in Migrelian language, which means natsui, while natsui is in Georgian language means burnt, scorch, burning and scorching. That's the masdar tsua. So no, that's a typical Migrelian prefix used to form the verbal passive verbal adjectives. Participles, and from hence we can conclude that Spanish word noche and Russian noche, of course, consist of this prefix, and only the first consonant of the root that used to mean burning, scorching. Burning, after you've burned something out, it's as black as the night. Parki in Georgian language means sack, pouch, or bag. So something to place, to put something into. That's the reason, that's the essence of the English verb to park something, into something, and eventually the word park and Spanish parque, a place to put something into. Spanish people are sure that they have etymology for the women's name Pilar. That's a famous Spanish name. I even don't remember how they explain it, because I don't need that information, because in Swan language Pilar means lips. Pirelli in Migrelian language means April. April, April, in Spanish that would be Abril. April, Pirelli, that definitely is the same. April in Russian language is one same word, but it's crooked, it's, the form was changed. Who did it, who borrowed it, who crooked it,
we now know, because we understand that Pirelli, that is the initial source for the whole chain, because it is an adjective made out of piri root, which means flower. By the way, in Ukrainian language, April is kvitень, which contains kvit, which is also flower. Fulano and Mengano, those are the words used to denote a person whose name you don't know. What's his name? Think I'm a Bob and think Gumajik. Never heard of such an English expression. You should know it. Okay, you know what I'm talking about. In English, in Georgian language, they have a very, very similar saying, plani da pistani. Fulano e Mengano, plani da pistani. Fulano and plani, definitely that's one the same. That's the same word. Can we explain it from the Spanish point of view? No way. Can we explain plani from the Georgian point of view? Definitely plani. That is something who relates to the action of pla. Pla, that's burial, some person, an undertaker, somebody who buries people. Barem in Georgian language is the same, means the same as porém in Portuguese language, nevertheless. Rioni, that's a river in the Meridian, and by the way, that's a lot of water, and it contains a clear suffix on. With this suffix taken out, we are left with the root ri or rio, which is a river in Spanish. We started our story with rumba, which means the sound of multiple drums playing at the same time. That would be the essence of the Cuban and African rumba. And this word comes from the Migrelian Masdar rumba, which means to hit strongly. While rumba in Icelandic language also means rain and its sound, obviously. This one is very, very important. Saume in Spanish language means smoking. And it definitely comes from the Spanish word humo, which means smoke. But how can you justify, how can you explain the presence of the sa prefix? Only from the Kartvelian point of view, where it is fundamental. The same can be said about a very curious word, sambambe. That's Dominican, the word used in Dominican Republic, but the word is Spanish. It comes from the Spanish language, Spanish dictionary. And it means a fight, a quarrel. If we assume that the root here is mbambi, then the sa would be the Kartvelian abstract noun prefix. And mbambe is, or more exactly, mbamba, that's the African equivalent of piranha, a very dangerous fish. And you can imagine if you throw a piece of meat into water where mbambas live, you can imagine that would be exactly sambambe, a quarrel, a fight for this meat. And a similar word, sambumbe, that would be in Spanish, in Colombia, that is kind of a dish made out of pumpkins and bananas. Or it may be just a mixture. And we now understand that if we are looking for, that we should look for the root mbumba, with sa being the Kartvelian prefix, we find the word mbumba in the historical dictionary of Malawi, where it meant and means female members of a family, which are definitely responsible for making dishes. This one is daring. That's a hypothesis, but it's if it proves proves itself, that would be a very, very loud finding. Sangre in Spanish language means blood. If we assume that it might be, this might be this same Kartvelian abstract construction starting with the sa prefix and having ngre as its root, we should look for ngeri, geri root in the Kartvelian languages, because Kartvelian languages tend to omit vowels while forming words. So ngr made out of ngeri, that would be a very typical for, say, Migrelian language. Ngeri, that's an easily found word in the Migrelian dictionary, meaning wolf. So in this case, sangre literally translates from the Kartvelian languages as where bloody, where wolves are, while sangre in Spanish means blood. Where wolves are and blood, that would be the connection between those two concepts. In Spanish language, sex would be sexo, while in Georgian language, sex would be skesi. Definitely the same word, but a little bit crooked. Who crooked it? Which version is correct? Who borrowed from whom? Sex or skes? What is what would the explanation be? Again, it's in favor of Kartvelian family, because C, that would be a rare but existing suffix in Kartvelian languages. For example, you see such a rare word as desi, which contains this same C suffix or saux plus inflection. That would be more of a sister, because sister itself in Georgian is da. Desi, that would be its derivation. Similarly, we may imagine that skesi is a derivation, such a derivation from the root ska or skua or ski or whatever. We already saw that. Skua, skili, ski word, which in Migrelian language means son or child. Child is something which is conceptually absolutely related to the word sex. Sila, that is sand in Georgian language, and that would be the reason why we have different silex, silice, etc. in European languages. This one is funny. In Spanish language, testicle, that would be testiculo, and we may assume that testiculo, that's a Kartvelian adjective made out of the root testiki. In this case, we might want to explain the meaning of testiki from the Kartvelian point of view, and it can be explained, and it can be explained perfectly. First of all, we look for the word for the root tes, which is semen or seed in Georgian language. You see it from the various words like teswa, tesia, tesli, etc. So that is semen. While tiki in Georgian language is something like wineskin, bagpipes, or esais, something that would be container. So from this point of view, testiculo is related to the container of semen, and that's the explanation from the Georgian point of view. You don't have any other explanation for this word. It's tricky, but it impresses. We didn't mention one important toponym, the ancient capital of Spain, Toledo, which in its Latin variant is spelled as Toletum, which gives us the possible Kartvelian toponym of Toleti, land of Toli. Tol in Swan language, that would be silex, and silex is the material that was added while during the production of the famous Toledan steel used for weapons. That's the secret of the Toledan steel, the mixture of silex, which in Georgian language is tol. You still can see quite a number of silex deposits around modern Toledo today. Trabaja in Georgian means boastful, braggart, while trabajar in Spanish means to work. The link between them is not obvious until you check the meaning of the Spanish word to boast. That would be jactar. One of the meanings is to move something, which means to work. Thus, the whole the circle is complete. The circle of meanings would be complete. In Spanish, onion is cebolla, cebolla. It's written in Ukrainian, that would be cebula. That's the same root, and as they claim, it comes from the Latin cepa, meaning onion as well. In this case, cepuli or cepoli, that would be a logical adjective made out according to the constructed according to the rules of morphology. In Georgian dictionary, we find sepi word, which means poor or barren earth. Exactly, that's the kind of earth. If you cannot plant there anything else, you plant onion. Onion, that's something that grows on such kind of land. In Georgian, ocean is ukiane. Sounds very, very similar. But in Georgian, it can be split into morphemes, while it cannot be split in Latin language or any other languages. Ukiane starts with the negative prefix, meaning absence, and kian, that would be ukiane, that's an abstract construction, meaning absence of the root. The root here is kian. Kian means to rock, to roll over, exactly what the waves, the water is doing in the ocean. While in the ocean, in this case, that would be the absence, that would be the stagnation. That ukiane would mean stagnation, absence of movement, absence of rocking and rolling. And that is exactly why the Pacific Ocean was called Pacific, and that's the biggest ocean on Earth. Barcelona may have such a funny explanation. First of all, we may interpret this starting B as V, because in Spanish language they sound virtually the same. At the same time, the presence of the C letter is a possible sign of X-C sound, because otherwise they could have easily used the S letter. But they decided to go for C. That means that it may have been C. In this case, Barcel is turned into Varcel, and that's already the Georgian word Varsli, Varceli formally. That means wooden knit intro, or more importantly, a small boat. From this point of view, Barcelona or Varcelona, from its Kartvelian interpretation, would be the place of small boats. A port for small boats. Verana in Georgian means uninhabited, while verano in Spanish means summer, a totally uninhabited period of year. Virgin or virgen in Spanish, or more importantly, vergine in Italian. The Italian word is exactly what we are going to analyze here. In Georgian language, the prefix ver means the impossibility of action. Thus, if we assume that vergine or vergin, it's spelled as vergin, vergine. In this case, we need to find in Georgian language, the root gin in the meaning of that would naturally allow adding the ver prefix, that means the impossibility of such action. This root is found in Georgian language in the form of the masdar gineba, and it means dishonor. So if you find add the prefix meaning the impossibility of dishonor, you will end up having vergine, virgine, virgin, the impossibility of dishonor, which is what virgin exactly is. One of the very, very fundamental things that any historical linguist should be aware of is the so-called Ypsilon problem. The secret is that no Ypsilon ever existed. This is the ancient Greek letter. We know it as Ypsilon, which in fact, in ancient times, was used to represent the U sound, not E sound. What it does today. Today in the Greek language and all over the world, Ypsilon and its derivative Y used to represent the E sound, while in ancient times formerly it was U sound. We should remember that about that always and forever, because it if you forget about that, we are sent into the totally wrong direction where we won't find any etymology for anything. It used to be, actually it's upsilon, it's not ypsilon. This letter was borrowed by Latin people wrongly as E sound, and later Greeks themselves re-borrowed a letter of their own in their own meaning. That's the tragedy of the modern Greek language. So from time to time, whenever you encounter the Ypsilon letter or Y letter or Y in any of the texts, you are obliged to assume that initially this sound should have been U. And from time to time you can find the words that we now spelled with the I letter, with E Roman. We can find examples when the same words are spelled with Y, with Y. That's natural because since in Latin language these two letters represent the same E sound, what's the point using both of them? And in those words, with the course of time, the Y letter, the Y, was replaced with E. So in 50% of all the cases where we see the presence of E Roman, we must assume that it may have been E Greek, and hence it might have represented the initial U sound. Difficult, but very, very, very important. So, and we, from time to time, we can see in medieval text, for example, Iglesia, which is church, spelled with Y, not with I, and that means that it should be considered as Uglesia, not Iglesia. Uglesia, that's a Kartvelian construction that with a negative U prefix followed by some gla verb. So if we want to decipher it, we need to find this gla verb in Georgian language, and it can be found. Gla means sadness, grief. So uglesia may mean something which has no sadness, no grief, or vice versa, because the u prefix in Georgian language has two meanings. And one of them is negative, and one of them is the forming of the superlative forms of adjectives. In this case, you need to add not only the U prefix, but also the C suffix that we see, clearly see that follows the gla root in the word iglesia. In this case, uglesia would be the most sad, the saddest, and which is quite close to the concept of what church actually is. Another example of the wrongly interpreted word because of the problem of Ypsilon is a so-called Indios. In fact, there have been no Indios or no Indians. The word used to be spelled through Y or Y as well, and it means that from the very start this word meant that was Undio, not Indio, and for that word we go to the Georgian language dictionary, where we find the meaning for Undo: untrustworthy, mistrustful, useless, vain, insignificant, simple, and plain. Wonderful words for to denote what we know as Indios or Indians, for one reason: no connection with India, just a Georgian. Clearly Georgian word. And this one is one of the most important things, because zapatear in Spanish language, this verb means to hit the floor with your shoes, because zapato in Spanish language means the shoe. But this movement, you are doing this movement with your feet, while feet in Spanish language is a foot or a leg, is a pato. And in this case you see that pato may have been the real root for the verb zapatear, but you don't know what to do with the prefix sa, tha, or more exactly tsa, because in most cases, especially when you need to make a bridge between Basque language, which does use the sound ts, and Spanish language, which doesn't use it, you will need in those cases definitely the z letter. So we do have a right to assume that if this is a prefix tsa followed by the root pato, which means foot, in this case you understand that you the overall construction may you understand why it means to hit the floor with your feet. The only thing you need to explain is the presence of the prefix, and this prefix is Kartvelian. Sa prefix is a fundamental Kartvelian prefix which has many meanings, and among them one of the most important is it makes perfect aspect forms out of the imperfect. So in this case and actually you see that the Spanish people have two verbs, zapatear and patear, meaning the same thing. The difference is in prefix, and the prefix, as we have now found out, is Kartvelian, Georgian. Another wonderful thing that would be a rare Spanish verb, sular or thular in a Spanish way, or tsular, if we assume that was the initial ts sound, I bet that it was, that would be to make mistake, while tsuli in Georgian language means child. So child and mistakes, you know what I'm talking about. Actually, the concept of family in Georgian language and in Kartvelian languages almost always bear very negative connotations. We will see that later on other examples, but this one is really impressive. Oh, 20 seats, 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 20